if you don't have a plan, you're guessing and then you're making decisions based on emotion.
Emotion. That's exactly right, Dean.
Okay, bud, we have right here on America's Wealth Management Show covered planning for retirement when you're in your 30s, planning for your retirement when you're in your 40s, and of course, we had a couple of our younger CFPs doing those episodes, but I encourage people to check them out, share them with your kids, your grandkids, whoever you know that's in that age group, and then you and I just did one recently on planning for retirement in your 50s. Now, a lot of the things that we talked about in your 50s are also applicable in your 60s, but this is really where the rubber meets the road. This is it, right? And we're not going to do one for retirement planning in your 70s, because if you're still working in your 70s, you either love it or you just didn't save enough to be able to retire.
I'm glad you said that. We call this the retirement red zone, because this is when you really have to crunch the numbers and get your plan in order and understand that the objectives that you have as a soon-to-be retiree can be achieved.
Mistakes for retirement planning in your 60s can be many times irreversible financial mistakes.
Yeah,
so you got to get this right.
You do indeed. But, you know, that's why we did the other shows, is there's a lead up to this, you know, because in the earlier years, what? You're just putting money away.
Well, you're deciding how much you need to save. You know, you've got really two things happening in your 30s, 40s, and 50s. You got the ability to live your daily life and how much you can spend safely and still be able to save enough to get to that ultimate retirement point. But here you are in your 60s now, and this is the time when decisions need to be made. Now, ideally, you've been planning and been working with a good certified financial planner along with a CPA since you've been in your 50s, and you've got this nailed down. But if you're in your 60s right now and you haven't started working with a good certified financial planner along with a CPA, you're behind the eight ball.
Yeah, and it may limit some of the things that we could have done earlier.
Right, right. So here's what we're going to do. We are going to go straight to our one and only retirement plan checklist.
Yeah. I want to say award winning, but that'd be a lie.
It won the award best piece by Bud Casper.
Yeah, in-house.
Nominated number one by Bud Casper.
That's right. I believe that.
So this retirement plan checklist, which by the way, anybody can get, has a lot of different things in here. There are timelines in here. What you should be doing 10 to 15 years out. What should you be doing 5 years out, 2 years out, 1 year out? And then there are age-based rules in your 50s and in your 60s and even into your 70s. But I want to focus on the actual checklist.
Sure.
30 questions. We're going to kind of buzz through these, and they may go a little bit fast, but it's okay if we go fast because you can download your copy. And this checklist is designed to be a conversation starter between you and your spouse of all the things that you need to be considering as you are heading toward retirement. Here we go. Number one on a retirement plan checklist. And by the way, these are in no particular order of importance.
Okay.
Number one says, it's a question for you. I have taken into consideration inflation and have been conservative in my planning using inflation of 3-4% per year. Yes or no? Have you done that? Why is that important, bud?
Sure. Well, it's important because inflation is a great eroder of wealth. And so therefore, having an understanding of what a real inflation rate is gives you achievable. You'll understand exactly what you need with inflation, let's say 3% or 4%. Now, hopefully, you know, Federal Reserve is doing their best to drive that down, and we got it down to, what, about 3.2% at the best. Now it's creeping back up again, so people that are anticipating that the Federal Reserve is going to be
cutting rates.
Isn't going to happen. And by the way, I'm on record.
Not tomorrow.
That's right. But I am on record as saying that they can't do that. You know, it's just they're too far behind at this particular point to be able to do that. I know it'd be a popular thing from the standpoint of what it might do to the stock market. But the reality is I don't think they're going to even be able to do it for the entire year.
Oh, I think we'll get one in before the end of the year.
But if they do it, it's for politics more than anything.
You know.
Whatever, right?
But on inflation, the way that you spend money on what you spend it on, things are going to inflate at a different rate. So you need to make sure you're applying the proper inflation rate to each area of your spending.
Yeah, and let's be more specific than that is, you know, if it was on today, we're using about 3.67%, I believe is what we're using in general. However, when we get to Medicare, now we're using around 6.5%.
Healthcare.
Yeah. So that we, you know, have a real number, not something that's just pie in the sky or average.
So there's another one here. I have assumed life expectancy beyond normal lifetime in my retirement plan. Okay, we call that longevity risk. Mm-hmm. Don't think about when your parents pass. Think about your own health. Add a few years to what normal life expectancy would be. Most of the time, we're planning between 95 and 100. And not everybody's going to make it there, obviously, but we'd rather have too much money at the end of our life than too much life at the end of our money.
Exactly right, Dean. You know, and that's what we call legacy planning as well. You know, and the truth of the matter is that many times when we're doing the planning, we might be exercising more income out of the plan in the earlier years than when in the later years. Why? Because as you get older, you're going to be less active and perhaps less active. And if that's the case, then it changes, you know, right. And really comes back into an almost now I'm growing my money again because I'm not spending as much as I did when I was in my 70s.
Well, that's our next question. I've thought about the amount of money I want to leave behind for my heirs in my retirement plan, and my spending budget is set to allow for that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's legacy planning.
Yep, right.
Number four, I've taken into consideration what's important to my family and to me, and my retirement plan is built around those goals.
Yeah, you know what I like about that, excuse me, Dean, is the fact about family meetings.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's become, I think, a little bit more popular. People, you know, are now understanding that having a meeting with the people that are going to be benefiting by your estate at their demise, you know, need to be kind of prepared for that.
Yeah, they do. Mm-hmm. They do. So here we go. I have thought about additional budget items during my retirement, such as new cars, housing expenses, dental, medical, grandchildren's college, etc. All those things. What do you want to do, right? So are those things important to you? And, you know, what do you want to be prepared for? How old is your roof? How old is your air conditioner? How old is your, you know, refrigerator and all your washer and dryer? Those things you need to think, okay, those things come up. And while you're working, okay, you can absorb those things into your budget, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you need to make sure that you're taking into consideration the possibility that those one-time expenses are going to come up.
Yes. And they're also going to inflate.
Exactly.
You know, so that's why we have to do it right.
Yep. Question number six, my retirement plan allows me and my spouse to see our progress towards long-term goals and ensure my path to success.
Mm-hmm.
That's critical.
It is, you know, and it's why we have meetings in our case, generally every 6 months or on demand. Things change. Events come up. Just had a client just a month ago that sold a very nice business, brought the assets over for us to manage. We had already been working with him and his wife, and it just flows smoothly, you know,
yep,
with that. But again, you know, they call to do their checks and balances associated. Where are we? Are we doing everything that we need to be preparing for this new phase of our life?
It's all part of the plan. All right, let's continue on the retirement plan checklist. Number seven, my retirement plan allows me to know how market changes will affect my ability to maintain my retirement goals.
I think it's one of the greatest fears that people have. We're investing money, but what if we have a real serious downturn? Or what if we have successive years of downturn? How is that going to impact my future income if all of a sudden the assets that are supporting my income flow are now depressed?
And you and I have been around long enough to know that that happens.
It happens. But we build in contingency so that people say, okay, let's say that we had a 20% drop in the stock market, which, by the way, doesn't mean that your plan is losing 20%. And the next year it's down 10%. You know, how much do we have to make up to be able to get to that level? Well, there are adjustments that need to be made. First off, you probably have to make some adjustments in the risk of your portfolio. But again, it's all part of the planning process. And the one good thing about all that is we can be pretty darn accurate.
We can. But if you don't have a plan, you're guessing and then you're making decisions based on emotion.
Emotion. That's exactly right, Dean.
Number eight, my retirement plan takes into consideration the possibility of higher taxes. Guess what? That's coming.
Yeah. Oh.
That's coming.
Yeah.
So how does that affect your ability? And you know, that goes right into the next question. These are two tied together, so let me get this one. My retirement plan is based on net numbers, so it can easily be adjusted for changes in the tax code. So what do I mean by that? what's the net amount of money you need deposited to your checking account month after month, year after year, decade after decade to ensure that you live the life you want in retirement. Net after taxes.
Exactly right. So we all know that the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act is going to sunset here on January 1st, 2026. That's going to be a serious change because, you know, one of the things that people really enjoyed when Trump put this into play, they liked the fact that they didn't have to itemize.
Yeah.
Because most of the time, you know, you get up to $19,000 some odd, you know, of exemption there. And people like that, Dean.
Now, personally, it'd do me any good.
Well, we're not talking about you.
Because we're limited on the state and local income tax deductions, right?
Right.
Which is part of the itemized deductions. And so for, you know, for a lot of people, those itemized deductions were far better than the standard deduction. For the masses, you're right, bud. The standard deduction, that increasing was a big deal.
Right.
All right. My retirement plan has been stress tested to take into consideration the possibility of poor market conditions at any point in my retirement.
You know, that's such a personal thing, but what we illustrate, and we do this through the use of screens, you know, from our computers up on, you know, big television screens. So people, we can take you through those difficult periods and actually illustrate what you're historically speaking, your portfolio actually did. And so we can come back and say, you know, this is what happened, you know, when this occurred, you know, could you have tolerated that?
Well, first of all, did it cause failure in the plan or did it cause you to have to adjust spending? And I think that's a more critical question than could you handle the fluctuations, right? Because
right.
If people know that those fluctuations aren't going to impact their ability to continue to spend that they want to spend from a historical perspective, then that kind of takes some of the emotion out of it.
Yeah, I guess I liken it to the Boeing situation. If you're not comfortable with how the plane was built and all of a sudden you get into a storm and you find out it's shaking all over the place, you know, then you have issues. You know, we can go through that.
Here's another one, stress testing. My retirement plan has been stress tested to take into consideration the possibility of a premature death and the effects on the surviving spouse. Mm-hmm. Look, that's important.
It is. And if there's one spouse's income that is going to be lost at death, then the question is, can the survivor, you know, subsist on that? Now, when we go through and look at this, you know, we generally have a rule that a surviving spouse, whether male or female, lives on approximately 85% of what they had when they were both alive. And so we stress for that situation. And again, it gives you a real comfort in understanding what all the probabilities are telling us as what the result would be.
Exactly right. So on that same vein, bud, my retirement plan has been stress tested to determine the impact of long-term care expenses versus the cost of long-term care insurance to make sure that my money is used most efficiently.
Yes. You know, and that's the one area of planning that has been so, difficult, you know, because, you know, we're inflating, you know, the health situation, as I said earlier, somewhere around 6.5%. That's a big number, Dean, that we're doing year after year. The question is, are we prepared for that additional cost that could occur?
Well, and look, you know, all these things are things that you need to be considering. And as we're building a financial plan, we're actually doing all of these things for you. And I think that's the critical thing. And by the way, if you're just joining us, we're talking about planning for retirement in your 60s. We are referencing questions that are in our retirement plan checklist, which you can download for free. There's no way we're going to get in this program, bud, to all 30
sure.
of the questions on the checklist, but these questions are critical. And like I said earlier, it's a great way to get a conversation started with your significant other to talk about all the things that you need to be considering as you plan for retirement.
Right. Yeah. And obviously what we're also hoping is our listeners, our viewers, take the words that we're sharing with you right now to heart because you're in control of your future. Now get somebody that can help you get to the finish line.
What's that saying? You can shape your future by the decisions and the actions that you take today.
Okay. See,
right?
I like that.
Yeah.
Who said that?
I did.
Yeah. Okay. I got to memorize that so I can quote Dean Barber.
Number 13 on our checklist, I've included in my retirement plan the possibility of using life insurance instead of long-term care insurance since mortality is 100% and there's no way to determine if long-term care expenses will be incurred.
You know, but my reply to that is yes and yes.
You
know,
need to do that.
Yes.
Right? You need to do that unless you have so much money that you're self-insured. My retirement plan is built to allow me to have the highest probability of achieving my goals and do so with the least amount of risk.
Yes.
Okay. I call this question 14 on a retirement plan checklist the Goldilocks portfolio, the one that's the just right for you.
Yeah, not too hot, not too cold, just right. Right. You
know. And I think that people are looking for a personalized approach to their investment strategy. And when you go through the planning process, that's exactly what you achieve. You achieve the personalized planning strategy that's specific to your personal situation. It's not a cookie cutter approach or some mutual fund that everybody else uses, because you have to do two things. Make sure that it gives you the highest probability of achieving all your goals, but do it with the least amount of risk possible, because we all know that risk is ever present in the capital markets.
Totally agree.
All right. Let's see here. Number 15, my retirement plan takes into consideration the effects of taking Social Security and the long-term impact of not only how much I will receive from Social Security, but how it affects my ability to meet my long-term goals and my spouse.
You've been paying in your entire working life. You know, you've got reached a point where now you're going to exercise out of that all that money that had been put aside, if you will, into an income stream. You want to know exactly that if I were to pass away ahead of my wife, you know, what's left for her? What would she get? And she'll get the greater of the two in most circumstances from that perspective. But when you look at that and put that one little element, Social Security, you know, that you've been having to pay all your working lifetime, and you look at it from the perspective of how much will that be, and is that going to negatively impact my spending power, we can show you exactly how it would.
And speaking of taxes and speaking of Social Security, number 16 on our checklist, ask the question, is my retirement plan taken into consideration the possibility that Social Security can be taken tax-free unless I disqualify myself? Most people don't even know how to disqualify themselves from having their Social Security be tax-free. If you listen to us talk about planning for retirement in your 50s, and even in your 40s, you can go a long way in setting up your spending plan in such a way where you can get Social Security tax-free in retirement.
Right, yeah.
But most people don't even think about it early enough, and they just think that, well, Social Security is Social Security. It is what it is, and it's taxed the way it's taxed. Well, yeah, that's a true statement. But also, Social Security is taxed different than any other asset, and it's how you get income from other assets in what amounts that can cause Social Security to become taxable.
So in the planning process, we want to have that so that there's no taxation on it, of course. But if not, what is it? Well, there's a level where 50% of it is taxed, and then there's another level where 85% of it is taxed.
And that's a lot of money.
Yeah, it is.
All right, number 17, my retirement plan considers taxes in such a way that I will know which account to spend from first and in what amount to keep taxes as low as possible over my lifetime.
Mm-hmm. And again, that's a strategy based upon what your income sources are, whether
that's
it's
right.
Taxable, tax deferred, tax free.
And this is where the CPAs on our team here at Modern Wealth really come into play, because once the retirement plan is set, then the CPA can come in and create the tax strategy or the distribution strategy that's most tax efficient, so that you know that you're not paying any more in taxes than what you absolutely have to.
And as a firm, Modern Wealth Management, you know, we realize that it is critical for us to be able to provide clients the best holistic approach that we can to all the financial needs that you have. And most certainly having a CPA engaged with that, it helps the CFP in the planning process.
All right, I'm gonna skip ahead here a little bit. I'm gonna go to number 19, Bud. My retirement plan can alert me if I've gotten off track so that my advisor can give me suggestions for getting back on track. This is like your GPS. When you stop to take a break, you're going to have a bite to eat, you're going to use the restroom or whatever. Or if there's an accident and you're having to take a detour, that GPS is constantly rerouting you, telling you what it's going to take in order for you to get back on your route.
Yeah.
And your retirement plan should actually be a living, breathing plan like that. So when you're reviewing that with your advisor on a regular basis, you can see your progress towards success.
We have what is referred to as a probability of success. And when we weigh in all the factors that are associated with spending and savings and distributions of those savings, we have that probability number that really we hold on to, because that's the one way that people can define their probability.
I'm going to skip to number 22, bud. I have conducted a Bud Casper Roth conversion analysis by first completing my comprehensive retirement income strategy, then overlaying the results of a Roth conversion to determine the appropriate amount, if any, of my traditional IRA to convert to a Roth. And of course, Bud was the founder and original member of our Rothaholic Club.
Yep.
And if you want to join the Rothaholic Club, it's all things Roth IRA. Really what it is it's us sending you information on a regular basis of all things to do with Roth. And Roth, of course, was put into action back in the Tax Reform Act of 1996, I believe, and authored by Senator Roth. Mm-hmm. So best part of the tax code ever written.
Right. And if you're not taking advantage of that and understanding how you can take taxes out of your life through Roth conversions, we'd like to talk to you.
Yep. Okay. Let's go to number 28. We're about out of time here. I've tested my plan to see which fixed income investments could be of value. Mm-hmm. That's a big one, because fixed income investments are generally going to be safer.
Right.
So, look, there's a ton here. don't take my word for it. Download your copy of the retirement plan checklist. And while you're out there, don't procrastinate. Click the button that says schedule a meeting, get a conversation started with our team, and see what we can do to help you not just get to retirement, but through retirement. And you know, with that, Bud, I want to thank everybody for listening to us here. What do you thought?
Yeah, well, you know, it's something that you can take advantage of, and it's no cost or obligation for you to do it. Go ahead and give us a call.
Even the conversation, that's right. Thank you very much for joining us here on America's Wealth Management Show. I'm Dean Barber, along with Bud Casper. Until next time, everybody stay healthy and stay safe.
Represent the opinion of Modern Wealth Management, LLC, an SEC-registered investment advisor. Information provided is for illustrative purposes only and does not constitute investment, tax, or legal advice. Modern Wealth Management does not accept any liability for the use of the information discussed. Consult with a qualified financial, legal, or tax professional prior to taking any action.